In this video, we're looking at a free fall problem where the mass experiences a drag force opposing the direction of motion. And this drag force is velocity dependent. It's going to increase as the speed of the object increases. And the model we're using for this is a linear drag force. That means the magnitude of the drag force is proportional to the speed by some constant k. Now you should know that a quadratic drag force is actually more realistic for the high speeds of a mass falling through the air. But we're solving the linear drag case first as kind of a warm-up because the math is quite a bit simpler. Now the big goal of this problem is to find the velocity of this mass explicitly as a function of time if we release it from rest from some height. Then we want to graphically compare that velocity function to the free fall without drag and see if we can make sense of how the two graphs compare to each other. And the final instruction here before we begin is that we want to use a coordinate system where the initial position is called zero and downward is positive. Now, when I gave this problem to my physics students, they had never seen anything like it. So I broke it down into a bunch of little pieces that kind of guide us through the solution to the problem. Not surprisingly, the first piece is to label all the forces acting on the mass as it falls. And that's simple enough. We have gravity pulling down with a magnitude of mg, and then our drag force opposing the direction of motion with a magnitude of kv. In part B, we're asked to find the velocity vt at which the drag force balances the force of gravity. So the idea behind this is that our drag force just keeps getting bigger and bigger as the mass keeps falling faster and faster. Eventually, you've got to get to a point where the drag force kv is equal to the force of gravity mg. And at that point, the mass is in equilibrium. The forces are balanced and the acceleration becomes zero. And we level off to a final velocity called the terminal velocity. So if we solve for the velocity here, we just get that our terminal velocity is equal to mg over k. Next, in part C, we're asked to apply Newton's second law to this mass and obtain an equation relating the velocity and acceleration. So we apply F net equals ma to this mass. And again, we're using a coordinate system where downward is positive. So mg counts as positive. And then I have minus kv that's pointing in the negative direction. There's the net force, and that's equal to the mass times the acceleration. Next, we're asked to replace the acceleration with the time derivative of the velocity in order to obtain a differential equation for v. So this is one of the things you realize as you get further along in physics. When you're writing down Newton's second law, you're writing down a differential equation. So we simply replace a with dv dt, the time derivative of the velocity, and we have a differential equation in v. In other words, an equation relating derivatives of v to v itself. Now we're going to put on our math hats and try to solve this thing. So in part E, we're told this differential equation is separable. And that means we can solve it by moving all the v dependents to one side and all the t dependents to the other side. And then the next step is to integrate both sides. So I'm going to go ahead and rewrite this differential equation, but with my dv dt on the left-hand side. So this is just the same thing from the last slide, but I ultimately want v on the left-hand side, so I just took care of that. Now we need to separate the v dependents and t dependents. So what I'm going to do is multiply both sides by dt. And now I see I can get all the v dependents on the left by dividing by the coefficient of dt, that's mg minus kv. So on the left-hand side, I end up with an mdv divided by mg minus kv. On the right-hand side, I have a dt. So our variables have been separated. And finally, we can solve this differential equation by integrating both sides. So we're going to integrate from the initial state to the final state. And there's a bit of a notational complication here. On the left-hand side, I'm going to integrate mdv over mg minus kv. On the right-hand side, I'm simply integrating dt. And we want to go from the initial state to the final state here. Well, the initial velocity was clearly zero, and the initial time we'll call zero. But what about my final state? That's just some arbitrary velocity along the motion of this object. And I can't call that v, because I'm using v as my integration variable. So we've been instructed to give that a slightly different name. I'm going to call it v final. And the same thing applies for the t integral. I can't just call it t up here. I'm going to call it t final. Now you may have noticed in some textbooks, they handle this issue by just leaving the upper limit alone. They'll just leave that as a v. And they'll call the integration variable like a v prime, just to distinguish it from the limit of integration. But this approach is going to work fine. We'll call the final velocity vf and the final time tf. So now it's a matter of just guessing antiderivatives and evaluating across the limits of integration. Well, the integral on the left is clearly the hard one here. And I remember that the integral of 1 over some variable expression is basically just the natural log of that denominator. But to account for the chain rule here, we need the derivative of the denominator sitting in the numerator. And the v derivative of that denominator is negative k. So we're going to manipulate some constants here and write negative m over k out in front of this integral from 0 to vf. And then our numerator is going to be a negative k. You can see when we distribute the constants into the integral, we get back what we started with, so that's good. My denominator is an mg minus kv, and we've got our differential dv hanging around. Then on the right-hand side, we may as well just compute this t integral because it's so simple. The antiderivative there just gives me t, and when I evaluate across the limits of integration, I end up with a t final minus 0 or just t final. So on the left-hand side, we have a negative m over k, and then we need the antiderivative of this integrand. Well, that's the natural log of the absolute value of the denominator. You've probably been taught in calculus you must have those absolute value bars. But in this case, and in many cases in physics, you don't need them, and I'll explain why not in a second. So this is all equal to t final. Now, why don't we need those absolute value bars? Because mg is always bigger than kv. The maximum possible value of the drag force is kv. But when v is smaller, the drag force is even smaller than that. So this argument is positive, and the absolute value does nothing. Now we evaluate across the limits of integration. And for my upper limit, I get a negative m over k natural log. Now using parentheses instead of absolute value bars, mg minus kv final. And then for my lower limit, I subtract that. There's a double negative giving me a plus here. And that's an m over k and natural log of just mg because we subbed in 0 for v. On the right-hand side, I have my t final. Now in part g, we're asked to solve for v explicitly as a function of time. We're also given instruction on a couple other things that we can do to simplify the answer. But first, we've got to solve for velocity as a function of time. So starting where we left off, this is the expression we had after performing the integrals after we separated variables. Now those natural logs should be combinable using log properties. I'm going to go ahead and factor out a negative m over k, leaving me with a natural log mg minus kv final. And again, that v final is what we're trying to solve for here. And then minus natural log of mg. Well, the difference of two logs can be written as a quotient of logs, so that's a good thing. And at the same time, I'm going to multiply both sides by negative k over m to get rid of those constants. So this gives me on the left-hand side the natural log of mg minus kv final over mg, and on the right-hand side, a negative k over m times t final. Now we can exponentiate to undo the natural log function, and this gives me an mg minus kv final over mg equals e to the negative k over m times t final. Next, we multiply both sides by mg, and then I'm going to subtract mg from both sides. So this leaves me with a negative kv final is equal to mg e to the negative k over mt final minus mg. Now we can divide both sides by negative k, and I'm going to move the positive term on the right-hand side to the front. So I end up with an mg over k minus mg over k e to the negative k over mt final. And here's where some of the hints come in to clean up the presentation of our final answer. Remember that mg over k was the terminal velocity for this mass. So I can replace mg over k with terminal velocity, and I can factor that out. Then the second issue is now that the integrals have been computed, I don't have to worry about the distinction between v and v final, t and t final. I can simply write my final velocity as a function of time using a v. So I end up with v equals vt times 1 minus e to the negative k over m, and then I can use a simple t for my final time. And our answer is nice and clean. Now, part H brings up a really important point as you move into more advanced physics and engineering courses. There's often no back of the book to check against, and you need to develop the skills to check that your answer is physically reasonable. And the way we do this is by looking at some limiting cases, so some extreme cases, and then making sure that our solution behaves correctly according to our physical intuition. So in H, we're asked to look at these two limiting cases. When t equals 0, do you get what you should? So I want to look at v of 0 and ask, is it reasonable? Well, physically what's going on is that was the moment the mass was released and its velocity better be 0. So if we plug in t equals 0, I have a 0 in the exponent for e, and e to the 0 is 1, and I get a 1 minus 1 in those parentheses and I get 0. So that one checks out. The other limiting case I want to look at is when t becomes large. Now technically this is a limit as t goes to infinity. So I have the limit as t goes to infinity of v of t. And that's a limit as t goes to infinity of this expression vt times 1 minus e to the negative k over m times t. Now, I'm not going to be formal about a limit of e to the negative infinity. E to a large negative exponent is 1 over e to a large positive exponent, and that goes to 0. This leaves me with only a 1 times vt left over. In other words, this limit comes out to vt, the terminal velocity. That's exactly the velocity we expect when the time becomes large. It's that upper limit on the velocity when we allow enough time to go by and the drag force eventually balances the force of gravity. So that checks out. Now we're starting to have a lot of confidence in our solution. Finally, we're asked to make a qualitative plot of our velocity function by setting all of our constants equal to 1. So m and k and g, we're just going to set them all equal to 1 because we want to get just a qualitative sense for the behavior of the graph. And the natural comparison here is to compare our graph of the velocity function to the graph of a free fall without drag. So when I have a free fall without drag, that's just an object accelerating with a magnitude of g forever. The velocity would be given by gt. But we're setting all of our constants equal to 1. So the plot we're actually going to look at is v equals t for that. And then we compare it to our free fall with drag. And again, that's given by vt times the quantity 1 minus e to the negative kt over m. But I'm setting all these constants equal to 1. Remember that terminal velocity was mg over k, so that's 1 also. And my velocity function simplifies to just 1 minus e to the negative t. I've color-coded this, so the free fall without drag is going to be the red curve, free fall with drag is going to be the yellow curve, and we'll bring in the plot of these things. And again, on this theme of limiting cases, we're trying to get just a couple key features out of this plot in the limiting cases. First, when t is very small, I expect the free fall with drag to be very well aligned with the free fall without drag because the drag force is very small, because the speed is still very small. And we see this feature in the graph. I have almost exactly the same behavior for a little bit until the speed starts to grow large enough where the drag force becomes a significant factor. So we see the acceleration of our free fall with drag curve decreasing. So the slope of that velocity graph is decreasing. Hopefully that makes sense because the net force is getting smaller and smaller as the drag force grows. And then in the long run, so out here for large values of time, we expect our velocity to level off to the terminal velocity, and that's what this horizontal asymptote is about. So that's actually the terminal velocity there. And that shows that the velocity of this object is going to level off to a constant value when the drag force gets to the point that it's balancing the downward force of gravity. So the object will fall forever at that same speed, at least until it hits the ground. If you enjoyed this video, or at least found it useful, check out another one by clicking one of the links on the left, or click the Zach's Lab logo on the right to explore dozens of physics and math playlists. As always, you can leave your questions, comments, and requests in the comments section below, and I'll get back to you within 24 hours. Thanks for watching Zach's Lab, and best of luck on your math and physics journey.